Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Gender Intelligence, Breakthrough Strategies for Increasing Diversity and Improving Your Bottom Line by Barbara Annis and Keith Merron. Narrated by Coleen Marlo. Preface. When Barbara began her journey in 1987 and Keith joined her in 2002, our sincerest intention and desire was to empower women in the workplace and help them navigate their careers. Time seems to pass so quickly when you're this deeply consumed in your work. The world has changed in so many remarkable ways in that span of time, and in collecting the information and stories for this book, we realized how much we have changed as well. Early on in her practice, Barbara was making the same mistakes most consultancies and heads of organizations were making, missteps many are still making today in their pursuit of gender equality and diversity. As with so many others back then, her focus was on coaching and training women to adapt to the world of business, to take charge of their careers as men would, and to advance, no matter how inauthentic and uninviting it felt. Keith joined Barbara 12 years ago after having spent the previous 20 years consulting to leaders to help them create organizations that are more vibrant, adaptive, collaborative, and inclusive. Together, they began to focus on more system-wide approaches to producing a transformation in the balance of men and women and the spirit of inclusiveness. We learned a great deal along the way. Most important, that gender, as it relates to the workplace, is not about women only, but about women and men together. And as we grew in our own gender intelligence, we became even more motivated to share with leaders and organizations what we had discovered to be the true sustainable path, the final and most profound leg of our collective journey to gender diversity and inclusiveness. That insight we had back then became our unifying theme and the driving force behind all our efforts, and it stands today at the heart of our practice and message. When men and women bring their genuine selves to the workplace and embrace each other's authenticity, they discover the true meaning of gender diversity and success equals not in number alone, but also in value and contribution. Through gender intelligence, we have helped many organizations break the code on gender equality. We have guided toward true diversity by teaching them to view gender from a strength through differences standpoint, rather than through equality in numbers and sameness in behavior. This transformational shift in thinking has brought greater economic value to these companies and contributed significantly to the personal and professional growth and happiness of their employees. This book is about that true meaning and the journey of gender-intelligent organizations today. As we collected our thoughts for this book, we couldn't help but reflect back on where we were when we had our first aha moment, that gender insight that altered the course of our thinking, changed our outlook for the better, and put us on the path to the practice we're engaged in today. Barbara's aha moment came while working with an organization that was trying, with all the right intentions, to close its gender gap, but failing. She says, "It was actually the very first organization I worked with that brought me that gender insight that changed my whole perspective and gave birth to gender intelligence. In all of our client meetings and discussions on closing the gender gap, we naturally thought only about women. We never considered men when the subject of gender would come up. They weren't part of the equation. It dawned on me that we were focusing on closing the women gap, not the gender gap. My aha moment was that this organization I was working with, or any organization for that matter, was not going to close the gender gap by just focusing on women and putting the burden on women to solve the woman problem. We had to involve men in a much greater and more meaningful way." Our practice transformed because of that aha moment. And as we embarked on working with men and women together, we were so pleasantly surprised at how interested many male leaders were and how committed they were to empowering women. We discovered that it wasn't that they were resisting or avoiding making changes or that they were intentional in their lack of awareness and interest. They, by and large, just didn't know what to do, and for many, didn't even know something had to be done. Keith's aha moment came at the end of what he thought was a successful leadership workshop. He says, "I've been an organizational consultant for over 30 years, committed to transforming organizations and making them more collaborative and inclusive. For the first 20, I had never paid particular attention to gender. Instead, my focus was on creating inclusive and collaborative cultures with a focus on leadership in general. About 13 years ago, I was facilitating a leadership workshop, and after the session, most of the men and several of the women commented that it had been a great experience for them. A number of female participants, however, said it felt a little too male for their tastes. I was shocked. I had never received this kind of feedback before. The women who shared those comments said they couldn't quite put a finger on it, but that the whole experience just felt too masculine, from the way in which I spoke to the examples I gave, and in the design of the workshop activities themselves. I am deeply grateful to these women, because through their feedback, I started to wonder about what I had been missing. Here I was, a relatively conscious man, committed to everyone being fully themselves and becoming powerful leaders, not so much in the image of what I might be, but in their own image, a key part of the workshop. And here was a group of women giving me feedback to the contrary. I took it to heart and began a deep journey of self-exploration about the many blind spots that I had as a man. I thought, if I'm at least this conscious and committed, and yet still missing some key awareness of my own blind spots, what about the consciousness and commitment of other men? What gender blind spots are preventing them from having this line of sight? Somewhere around that time, Barbara and I met, and it opened my eyes to a whole world of gender differences that I hadn't been aware of. After that, I was all hands in and totally committed to gender intelligence and the work we are now all about. Barbara set out on this journey 27 years ago, and Keith more recently, to lift the veil on our gender blind spots and misunderstandings and raise the level of appreciation for gender differences in general. Along the way, we have had the privilege and honor to work with some of the top organizations throughout the world, most of which are Fortune 500 companies. To date, we have worked closely with the leaders of well over 100 such companies and have, along with them, learned much about what it takes to produce lasting change, and of course, have made many mistakes along the way as well. This book is an amalgam of that experience, and much more. It is a manifesto designed to challenge some of the prevailing beliefs about gender, differences, leadership, and organizational life, meant to provoke, prod, and catalyze a new and emerging way of being. We believe that organizations shape the face of the world, and that to make our world truly sustainable and create organizations that are highly effective in an ever-changing, uncertain, and highly competitive environment requires the principles and practices expressed in this book. It is intended to produce a revolution of thought and action such that organizations are far more fluid, inclusive, innovative, and effective. Moreover, our desire was and remains to produce an outcome such that books of this nature are no longer required. We realize that we may not get there for some time to come, but for leaders and their organizations that have the integrity, courage, and commitment to challenge their own thinking and that of others about gender and its role in organizational well-being and effectiveness, the principles embedded in this book will serve as important guideposts along their journey. In this book, we present how a small but growing number of courageous, leading-edge companies have been able to break through the barriers to women advancing in leadership. They have made the remarkable transformation from compliance to choice, from pressure to preference. They have discovered that the true measure of gender equality does not reside in a percentage, but in the untapped power of gender-intelligent men and women openly working and succeeding together. And the leaders in these forward-leaning companies have demonstrated the strength of conviction it takes to transform company culture and benefit from the diversity of thought, talent, and skills that both men and women bring to the table. As a result, these companies are far surpassing the financial outcomes of their less effective counterparts, many of which have stalled out because they continue to embrace the paradigms of the past. This book marks the beginning of that journey. In it, we offer both a perspective and a roadmap. We chronicle what companies are doing that works and what they are not doing but need to, and what leaders are discovering as they challenge themselves and their organizations to lift to a higher level of being and performance. Together, we often express our dream with this reflection. What if we understood, appreciated, and valued each other well enough and genuinely enough to the point where men could speak for women and women could speak for men? Imagine the spirit of collaboration that would exist in businesses and in governments throughout the world. The inclusion of educated and aspiring women would have such an amazing economic impact, especially in countries experiencing huge talent shortages expressly because their traditional cultures undervalue half their populations. This is the transformational conversation that is taking place today, a new perspective shaped by a greater understanding of our gender differences and the value created when we embrace and engage those differences. To us, this is not just a dream. We clearly envision a day when our gender blind spots become a thing of the past, when gender-intelligent men and women seek out each other's authentic nature and work and live together in a natural and openly inviting way. Disclaimer. Although throughout our book we identify and describe the differences between men and women, we acknowledge that our gender differences are a result of cognitive and behavioral tendencies, first informed by nature, then influenced by culture. This is not to suggest that men will always think and act one way and women will always think and act another. We speak in terms of inclinations and tendencies. Part 1. A New Conversation. 1. Gender intelligence. There's a different conversation taking place today between men and women in the workplace. A transformational conversation that's altering the landscape of business and how we're addressing gender diversity at work. After decades of ineffective finger-pointing and quotas, a revolutionary and effective approach has come into focus for men and women leaders, one shaped by a greater understanding of our gender differences and the value revealed when we engage those differences, instead of trying to ignore them. This awareness is stirring, growing stronger every day in North America, Europe, and in organizations around the globe. On an individual level, this new approach is improving communication between men and women. It's resulting in more effective problem-solving, in a dual-sided approach to innovation, decision-making, and in increased satisfaction at work and at home. Company-wide, this revolutionary approach is offering organizations significant strategic and economic advantage over companies that are not yet awake to its profound potential. While other businesses are stuck in conventional wisdom, these organizations are moving forward with confidence into the ever more competitive global market, able to leverage fully the efforts of every leader and every member of their teams. And we need a new approach now more than ever. Consider the amazing social changes that have transpired over the last 50 years compared with where we stand today. In education, we've seen a tsunami of women attaining university and graduate degrees in virtually every country on the planet. In many of those countries, women have been surpassing men since the 1980s. This flood of ambitious women seeking careers and starting businesses of their own doesn't show any signs of receding. More and more women hold important leadership positions in top companies and in governments alike. Yet after so much time and effort, one would think that women would be near to an equal level with men in career opportunity, compensation, advancement, and attainment of leadership positions. They are not. The sobering reality is that although women now represent 50% of the workforce, from entry positions all the way through middle management, women have done no better than to secure about 1 out of every 5 senior management positions and only 1 in 10 CEO or board-level posts. After more than 40 years of trying to break the glass ceiling, all we've done is push it up. What have we been doing wrong? The answer is clear. In the past, we've operated from 2 fundamental beliefs. The first is that balanced gender representation should be achieved in business, government, and education. To achieve that goal requires viewing both genders as identical on the inside. The reach for equal representation has been a tangible and worthy demonstration of our search for gender equity, to be sure. However, we've found that equalizing the numbers doesn't necessarily result in true gender equality or in creating the gender balance we were seeking. Similarly, many believe that treating everyone the same will eradicate bias, another move toward gender equity. Our research and experience show that this is hardly the case. What if the solution isn't eliminating the differences between men and women themselves, but instead learning how to recognize, value, and leverage those differences? Many companies who call on us have come to the realization that the focus on sameness and equality in representation has done little to produce meaningful change in the upper echelons of the organization. They're finding that quotas don't get them to gender diversity, and the gender diversity doesn't automatically make them become gender intelligent. And even after setting these quotas, they're not making them. After targeted recruiting and hiring of more women, the companies are simultaneously losing them. Yet too many are still holding fast to their beliefs, suspended in an ineffective but politically correct paradigm. The question is, what's causing their denial? Our collective limiting belief that women are leaving is evidence of the fact that the organization, especially at the top, is not providing a culture that allows for effective collaboration with their male colleagues and that contributes to the women's success and ultimately the organization's success. The reason why the glass ceiling still exists has more to do with organizations not providing a welcoming environment for women than anything else. The natural way in which women's voices are expressed is not part of the model for success for women at the top, a model based primarily on the way men think, communicate, and act. The standard explanation as to why women haven't advanced into the top ranks is often rationalized as work-life balance. And while many men cite this as the primary reason why women aren't progressing, and sometimes ultimately quit, it's not entirely their fault for making that assumption. Women perpetuate this myth by citing personal as their reason for not throwing their hat into the ring for a higher level position or when submitting their resignation. To call out the real reason they fear might burn important bridges, damage their professional networks, and possibly eliminate the possibility of returning. Men assuming women simply don't choose to pursue those top positions, and women reinforcing that assumption, has fostered our collective limiting belief that work-life balance explains the woman problem that continues to plague major corporations throughout the world. From our experience working with hundreds of companies attempting to solve these problems, both of these assumptions are incomplete. In fact, they're not even close. Yes, work-life balance is an issue for many women all over the world to varying degrees, dependent on support, means, country, and culture. But our research and experience show that work-life balance explains only a small part of what's really going on. The lion's share is the lack of a blended conversation at the top of the corporation and the inability to utilize the differences between the genders for the organization's collective advantage. Contrary to popular belief, when women quit, most aren't completely opting out of the business world. Many leave to join up with a competition or start their own businesses, and in record numbers. Many people think that this is so they can have greater work-life balance, but this is rarely the case. Instead, they are seeking to be a part of or create on their own working environments that value their ideas and contribution and allow them greater self-expression. Women-owned businesses in the United States have been growing at twice the rate of all privately held firms since the 1990s, and the same seeds of self-determination have taken root in Latin America, Europe, and Asia as well. Worldwide, women now own or operate a third of all private businesses, and this percentage is growing at a faster rate than that of private businesses owned by men. So when we combine the limiting beliefs of gender sameness and diversity of numbers with the misrepresentation that women leave primarily for work-life balance reasons, we arrive at a place where organizations can't take advantage of the greater gender potential that lies in blending the best of what women and men can uniquely offer. Assumptions abound and a unique and powerful opportunity is lost. Fortunately, a growing number of leaders and their organizations are foregoing this narrow focus and breaking these tired old patterns of thinking. They are uncovering the value of gender difference, not sameness. They are embracing diversity in thought, a more powerful and productive goal than numbers of men versus numbers of women. They're understanding the powerful business case to be made for this approach as the source of improved problem solving, better decision making, and greater productivity. They are realizing for the first time that the path to creating healthier, more effective, more balanced organizations is not just through the advancement of women, but by understanding, valuing, and blending the contributions of men and women together. They are growing in their gender intelligence. We are at the crest of a paradigm shift in thinking, a tipping point in our understanding of the nature and direction of gender equality in the 21st century, and gender intelligence is the leading edge of that understanding. What is gender intelligence? For decades, IQ was viewed as the sole measure of a person's intelligence. Society placed all its emphasis on educating people to improve their logical reasoning, math, spatial skills, use of analogies, and verbal skills. What was puzzling, though, was that while IQ correlated with academic performance to some extent, it did not correlate nearly as expected with professional success. While at the extremes, there was some relationship to success. At lower IQ levels, for example, people don't perform as well. In the middle and higher levels, it did not predict professional success at all. Clearly, there was some missing factor. There remained those men and women with great IQ scores who were not achieving their goals in life nor advancing in their careers. In some way, they seemed to be thwarting their potential by thinking and behaving in ways that hindered their chances to succeed. Around 30 years ago, social scientists figured out what that missing element might be in the success equation. Emotional intelligence, EQ, is a concept formulated by psychologists John D. Mayer and Peter Salovey during the 1980s and made popular in 1995 with the groundbreaking book Emotional Intelligence by Daniel Goleman. Emotional intelligence describes the ability to perceive, assess, and manage the emotions of oneself and of others. Although EQ went a long way in expanding our idea of intelligence by adding in the emotional component, it didn't go far enough in distinguishing the underlying characteristics by gender, including vital pieces like how we communicate, how we respond to social cues in our environment, and how we respond to and manage stress. Enter gender intelligence, an idea we find to be an exciting expansion of the complex conversation around predicting and maximizing potential, not just in our interpersonal dealings, but at the team and organizational levels as well. In the following chapters, we hope you will also begin to see what this more complete and gender-balanced notion of intelligence, one more revealing and inclusive of the differences between the genders, can bring to our personal and organizational success. At its core, gender intelligence is an understanding of and appreciation for the natural differences between men and women that goes beyond the biological and cultural to include variations in brain structure and chemistry that influence thoughts and actions. Gender intelligence is the awareness that gender differences are first informed by nature, then influenced by family, education, culture, and environment. Gender intelligence doesn't come to a person by ignoring or tolerating gender differences, or to an organization by pursuing a quota. Nor does gender intelligence require that men and women give up their authenticity in order to get ahead. A company doesn't become gender intelligent by simply enforcing diversity compliance policies, offering flexible work programs, or creating women-only networks or interest groups. Instead, gender intelligence comes from understanding and appreciating the unique talents and skills that men and women bring to the table, and how their natural complement can improve the productivity, innovativeness, and economic growth of the organization. It teaches us that once we're aware of how and why men and women generally think and act as they do, we can begin to understand each other's natural tendencies as well as our own. We can begin to engage the other gender more effectively in the workplace and feel the effects ripple out to touch our personal lives as well. As men and women come to understand each other's ways of thinking and acting, they step up to a new and powerful level of conversation. They stop tiptoeing around differences and are freed of their frustration. As they understand and appreciate each other's unique contribution, they begin to include each other more confidently and more willingly, and uncover the hidden value in their differences. This is where we begin to see the true transformational nature of gender intelligence. Not only are conflicts and miscommunication minimized, but women and men alike engage in a more open, expansive conversation that produces powerful results. Internal teams display enhanced problem-solving and decision-making skills as they fully utilize what each gender brings to the table. As gender intelligence infuses throughout the organization, turnover decreases, performance improves, and the company forges better connections within the marketplace. In the time we've been advocating for gender intelligence and supporting Fortune 500 companies in their leadership and cultural transformations, we've witnessed the blind spots that are deeply ingrained in the minds of men and women and in the cultures of organizations alike. These perceptual obstructions delay and even prevent the transformation from gender sameness to gender intelligent thinking. The good news is that the blind spots are easy to target and are fixable. Just being aware of them can start you on your own path toward gender intelligence. Our biggest gender blind spots. Through survey results of more than 240,000 quantitative and qualitative statements collected from men and women leaders and managers across the globe over the past 27 years, we've amassed a wealth of information about the differences in the thoughts and actions of men and women. From that data, we've identified a number of blind spots. Gender blind spots are the incorrect assumptions held by men and women that cause accidents of miscommunication and misunderstanding, and help maintain the status quo in gender relations in companies around the globe. These blind spots are not only preventing men and women from working and succeeding together more effectively, but also tend to frustrate organizations seeking culture change, innovativeness, and financial growth. Let's explore. Blind spot number one, the belief that equality means sameness. In conflict with our lived experiences, we've been indoctrinated by anti-bias programs and well-meaning gender equality efforts to believe that men and women should think and act the same way, engage the world and relationships the same way, and approach their careers in the same fashion and for the same reasons. This belief is supported by the deeper conviction that socialization is the primary determinant of our behavior. If it were not for the early and suppressive influence of parents, school, and culture, men and women would engage the world the same way. More than any other blind spot, this is the one that contributes most to our talking past each other and misreading one another's intentions. This is also the blind spot that leads us to make uneducated assumptions that may be completely off the mark about the meaning and motivations behind the behavior of others. Blind spot number two, the male-designed organization. It's no coincidence that the model on which almost all businesses have been structured since the Industrial Revolution is defined by machine-like characteristics of speed, efficiency, and clear hierarchy. This model was designed by men for men. If the keys to success are order and efficiency, then what better management style to adopt to ensure that success than the hierarchical military model of command and control? In the modern age, men created an organized, competitive work environment that rewarded speed in decision-making, individual performance, and attainment of measurable goals. The automotive industry, following the industrious example of Henry Ford, is an excellent example of speed in production, efficiency in assembly, and reporting structure from the factory floor to the corporate office. We've come a long way since the belching smokestacks of the industrial age, yet that same work model is still the dominant paradigm. Because it aligns well with the way men naturally think and behave, it makes it difficult for them to consider their workplace and their performance in it from any other perspective. A hardwired propensity in men to systematize motivates, aligns, and empowers them when there is a routine in place and there are rules governing that system. Because so many in the workplace can't even see an alternative, they maintain the belief that this is the best paradigm, for now and in the future. Male-led companies don't question the blind spot because they simply don't recognize it. Supporting this paradigm is well over 200 years of practice and refinement, making this male-designed model still considered by many as the most effective and efficient way of conducting business and leading and managing people. While that may have proven true in the past, We exist now in a rapidly shifting global business environment where we can't afford to leave the talents of half the workforce unrealized. Unfortunately, the initiatives and systems we put in place to better take advantage of women's talent are not accomplishing their goals. Instead, they make women the problem for not having made it to the top on their own volition and capability. Blind spot number 3, fixing women to think and act like men. Popular for decades, now more than ever, there is an effort to get women to approach and engage in their careers by acting like men. When we conduct a diagnostic analysis of an organization, in almost all cases, we discover that embedded within women's networks, in coaching sessions, even in university courses, are training programs designed to help women fit in, instead of designed to bring out their own uniqueness and authenticity. This phenomenon started in the 1980s when a deluge of books and training programs emerged, designed to help women learn to dress for success, manage their way to the top, and learn the keys to executive success. Almost always, they were being taught how the men play the game in corporate life. To this day, women coming into corporations have few options but to learn to adapt as best they can and not appear different, especially toward the top. Fixing women perpetuates the belief that women's contributions and styles are inferior to those of men. Not only do the women feel disenfranchised and discouraged, because of this blind spot, there continues to be a huge opportunity lost for many organizations given the fundamental shift in business over the past 40 years, the influx of women into the workforce, and the growing influence of women in the marketplace. The forces behind this change, a global economy, new technologies, the power of the consumer, a focus on knowledge instead of industrial production, and the changing face and demands of a new workforce are altering our standing beliefs about leadership, organizational structure, and business strategy, and call for a new, multi-layered, and more nuanced way of doing business that can connect better with the marketplace and operate more fluidly in a global environment. If we can stop fixing women and instead open both genders up to new possibilities and ways of being and doing, we can harness the full potential of all that talent we have at our disposal and compete and succeed in new ways in this changing business environment. Blind spot number 4, assuming the off-putting behaviors of men are intentional. Women in today's workplace often feel dismissed for their ideas and excluded from events and opportunities for advancement. They often state that they have to work harder than men do just to prove themselves half as good, and often feel doubted for their competence and commitment. Men, on the other hand, are generally comfortable in today's corporate culture. They assume and expect that women want to engage in work as men typically do, whether in prioritizing issues, solving problems, participating on teams, leading others, or making decisions. While the men we talk to don't feel they're acting intentionally against women, it's also true that in general, they are not as aware of how their behavior affects women. Oftentimes, leaders have no idea why their senior women walk out the door. The majority of men are not trying to be dismissive or exclusionary. They're just doing what often feels right for the company and not really thinking about the effect their actions tend to have on women in the workplace. While in reality, the men are not cognizant of the extent of the discomfort women feel when made to engage like men, there is still the perception by many women that men are aware of the effect, but simply don't care. As an example, during meetings, men will be most inclined to zero in on a solution and settle on a quick decision, seemingly ignoring or dismissing questions or alternative ideas commonly raised by women on the team during meetings. They don't ignore because they want to be off-putting. Instead, they feel derailed by anything that isn't front and center, so they press on. The men are doing what comes naturally to them, yet women often feel excluded by men's tendency to strictly adhere to agendas and rush to decisions and imagine it is intentional, even though it rarely is. You can see why we consider these assumptions the biggest obstacle to women understanding men and men understanding how they're being received. If we assume the other gender has the same understanding, motivations, and meaning in their behavior that we do, and they act in ways that are counterproductive or that inhibit our success, we'll feel taken off track, confused, slighted, dismissed, or angry. The confluence of blind spots. The presence of these four blind spots produces a set of symptoms that we repeatedly discover whenever we perform an organizational diagnostic, suggesting that there's a much larger phenomenon occurring caused by the confluence of these obstructions. The symptoms include women quitting and staying. They're delivering good work, but they no longer have the aspiration to advance. The creation of networks and training for women that are not necessarily gender intelligent. Leadership and management behaviors that are incongruent with the organization's policy and value statements. Great initiatives embarked upon with a lot of commitment and passion that end up as window dressing. Meaningful parts of the company, senior leadership, or sectors like IT and sales that remain predominantly occupied by men. Women in senior management who are seldom in positions with P&L or line responsibility, but rather are in support sectors such as HR, diversity, and communications. Senior women leaders often not wanting to make gender diversity a top priority in order to avoid pushback. More women than men leaving in many key roles. Senior men seemingly unaware of the aforementioned phenomenon or explaining it away as just a symptom of women not being able to cut it in a difficult competitive environment. Hiring and promoting practices that tend to unconsciously favor men. Interviewing and assessing men and women based on sameness. That we see these over and over again prompts us to consider that they are more than just a set of problems. They are symptoms of something deeper. They are part of an underlying paradigm that is hard for leaders to see. If we as leaders believe that the way we lead is intelligent, just, and wise, then when phenomena such as the aforementioned occur, we tend to write them off as anomalies, as irrelevant, or we have explanations that focus on the inability of the individual or group. In this way, a leader's beliefs become self-reinforcing of the current paradigm and in his or her style of leadership. We believe, however, that the cause of the four blind spots and these consequential symptoms, which we will cover more fully in Chapter 11, is not an anomaly at all. It is the direct result of the presence of a sameness mindset that fails to see the wisdom and value of gender intelligence in leadership and organizational cultures. Developing that intelligence is the antidote that cannot be seen from the current paradigm. And it is this very same paradigm that our narrative is intending to break. It begins with recognizing and valuing our differences. The science that underlies our differences. Researchers in neuroscience have made great strides in identifying gender differences in human brain anatomy, chemical processes, and functions. In fact, brain studies of more than 1 million participants in more than 30 countries over the past 20 years have shown conclusively how physiological differences in the male and female brain influence memory, emotion, hearing, and spatial orientation. The difference between men's and women's behavior has been discussed in relationship terms for some time. Too often the behavioral difference has been the only focus. While it's important to understand and realize how men and women often communicate, solve problems, prioritize, make decisions, resolve conflicts, handle emotions, and deal with stress differently, we can't stop there. We have to recognize that the differences have purpose, meaning, and value. The major reason our species has been so successful for millions of years is directly due to our gender differences, differences naturally designed to complement, not compete with, the opposite gender. Instead of driving us apart, those differences were made to help us work together, once in hunting and gathering, and now in the boardroom. Too often we think of socialization as taking primacy over biology. Although nurture, training, and education shape the male and female brain in important ways, hormones also play a critical role. Sex hormones work on the embryonic brain and nervous system, causing the structure or wiring to develop differently in males and females. This process starts as early as the first trimester of pregnancy and bears the ultimate biochemical responsibility for producing our gender-related differences. The way those differences play out most dramatically between the sexes is in how they think. According to anthropologist Helen Fisher, women tend to think contextually and holistically. They tend to think in webs of factors, not straight lines. When women think, they collect more information from their environment and arrange their thoughts into more complex patterns. They see more relationships between different elements and weigh more variations before they make their decisions. Men, on the other hand, tend to focus on a particular issue, omit extraneous data, and move in a more step-like fashion towards the goal, Fisher says. And our experience bears this out. What we find exciting is not how far apart these two ways of thinking appear to be, but the possibility inherent in the difference. Instead of thinking in a male way or in a female way, what if we were able to combine the two in making our most important business decisions? Fisher says they're perfectly good ways of thinking, both of them. But perhaps more important, men and women were built to put their heads together, not only in their professional lives, but in their personal relations as well. As the sexes come together to understand their different strengths, each has the opportunity to gain priceless insight into the other's world. Both have the opportunity to achieve new empathy and rapport. When men and women understand the biological nature of their gender differences, assumptions and misunderstanding are lessened and their lenses broaden. They gain the opportunity for greater appreciation for each other's behavior and actually learn more about their own, too. Starting with the science lifts us to a new level of conversation and encourages us to include and work with each other more productively. For example, men are naturally inclined to get the problem solved by narrowing down and implementing solutions as quickly as possible in a most decisive and non-ambiguous fashion. On the other hand, women instinctively collaborate, ensuring that all voices are heard and all options explored before making a decision. The advantages of gender intelligence. In the chapters to come, you will see how proactive and forward-thinking it is for an organization to trade in quotas and start down the road of gender intelligence. We're talking about a sea change from the mindset and focus of the leaders to the corporate culture as a whole. Through our work, we've witnessed the powerful shift that occurs when an organization as a whole begins to behave more productively and effectively as a result of gender-intelligent leadership and systems. The functions, strategies, and processes begin to change to reflect more expansive thinking, which affects almost every single pore of the organization's being, influencing how it markets and sells its services or product, how functions relate to one another, how human resources are managed, how talent is accessed, hired, and leveraged, and how the top leads. There are a number of highly successful organizations showing the way. They are instilling what we call a culture of difference thinking, fueled by gender intelligence. These well-known companies are beacons for talented professionals. They're recruiting and retraining the best and brightest men and women across a number of industries, and showing a record of proven success that previous methods were never able to achieve. Here you will learn about the journey taken by each of these organizations. Each had an aha moment or discovery that was the catalyst for them to make profound changes and invest in future success. The beginning of a new conversation. This isn't just a book about increasing gender diversity in the workplace. Leaders looking to succeed in the current organizational paradigm should look elsewhere for resources and support. This book is about fundamental change. We wrote it for leaders who want to lead in a gender-intelligent paradigm. It is a clarion call for difference thinkers in positions of power who have the ability and willingness to alter forever the culture of their organizations. Gender intelligence serves the needs of individuals who, unsatisfied with the status quo, are ready to break out of old patterns of behavior and awaken their organizations to what is possible. 2. The science behind our gender differences. Back in the late 1970s, a researcher sat slumped in his chair, running his hand through the rough stubble on his chin. He was stumped. He'd struggled along with his colleagues, trying to find the answer to a profound puzzle. Why did male and female victims of stroke recover from the resulting speech impairment and loss of memory so differently? On average, men had a far more difficult time regaining their ability to talk and recall past events than women did. researchers finally did arrive at what was then an isolated scientific breakthrough, but now appears to be so obvious as to cause us to wonder why they couldn't figure it out at the time. This revelation that the brains of men and women are clearly different proved a watershed moment in medical history. It prompted scientists and medical researchers across the globe to delve further into this side of brain science, opening the door to a broader exploration of brain-based gender differences in the decades that followed. Tremendous advances in imaging technology in the 1990s allowed brain research to go even further in what was deemed the Decade of the Brain, a movement sponsored and funded by the Library of Congress and the National Institute of Mental Health. During that time, we crossed a critical threshold in our knowledge of human behavior, and the last few decades have brought a stunning evolution in our understanding of the hardwired differences between men's and women's brains, and how those differences affect behavior. Before that time, scientists were in the dark, many discouraged from looking for those differences in the first place. While technology was accelerating our ability to learn more and investigate the biological differences between the genders, the feminist movement was applying the brakes, demanding the opposite response. Rallying cries from women declared, "We are equal," and women across the country were advocating for the same treatment as men. Although the movement had positive intent, it also had a suppressive effect on individuals and institutions attempting to conduct research into biological differences. There was a palpable fear of challenging the social call for gender blindness. Moreover, the almost exclusive use of men as test subjects impeded progress in this area. Based on the standing belief that there were no gender differences aside from physical appearance and reproductive capability, many scientists assumed studying male brains and behavior would sufficiently explain physiological functions in both genders. Their motivation in using only male subjects was twofold. First, if the research being done included some chemical or pharmaceutical treatments, they didn't want to put potentially pregnant women at risk. While visibly pregnant women would not have volunteered to be part of the study, researchers were unwilling to risk the chance of including a test subject unknowingly in the earliest stages of pregnancy. The second reason had everything to do with differences between men and women. In general, women have more hormonal activity going on at any given time in their bodies, especially around their menstrual cycles. Researchers work by isolating variables, and adding in active hormones impeded their selection of independent variables unaffected by external factors. Because men's hormone activity is more constant, they made more reliable subjects. Emblematic of the insights that many researchers have had recently, one of the leading medical researchers in neuroscience today talked about her own personal and professional evolution in understanding how biological differences matter. In 1990, Dr. Marianne J. Legato, professor of clinical medicine at Columbia University and founder of the Foundation for Gender-Specific Medicine, was asked by the American Heart Association to author a book on women and cardiovascular disease. "To the intense amusement of my colleagues now," she said, laughing, "my answer was, why? What's different about women's hearts compared with those of men?" Legato did the research and was astonished to discover how differently men and women experience coronary artery disease. Men's hearts are not only larger, they actually have a different protein composition than those of women, Legato says. "It occurred to me that if the hearts of men and women were so very different, perhaps there were differences in other body systems." And she embarked upon a research career that focused on exploring those differences. Her conclusion? Although nurture, training, and education importantly shape the male and female brain, there are differences that are hardwired in. And it is a confluence of our genes, whether we are XY or XX, and our hormones that cements that sense of ourselves as male or female into the brain. Legato admitted that she hadn't wanted her research to show what it did. In fact, at first she found proven biological differences between the male and female brain a somewhat troubling discovery. But in the end, there was no denying it, she said. Gender differences stubbornly emerged like dandelions on a chemically treated lawn. Research like Dr. Legato's, along with that of a slew of others, coupled with the technological advances in imaging of the last decades, has produced an explosion in our knowledge of the differences between the brain structures and functions of men and women, as well as deepened our understanding of the influence of hormones on human behavior. The science that underlies our differences. Beginning in the early 1990s, neuroscientists across the globe began successfully and convincingly illuminating biological sex differences in brain structure, chemistry, and function. In study after study, findings have shown the variations that occur throughout the brain, informing and influencing the, at times, dramatically different ways men and women communicate, listen, solve problems, make decisions, handle emotions, deal with conflict, and manage stress. But before we break down the differences in brain structure and chemistry that help dictate gendered behavior in order to more fully understand why men and women act the way they do, we want to put forward a disclaimer. When we speak of gender differences, we are describing a bell curve of gendered tendencies. This means there is a distribution of behavioral phenomena along a continuum, with a greater number of people exhibiting tendencies that fall toward the middle or norm. In layperson's terms, if we organized all men on a continuum from factual to intuitive, more of them would fall toward the factual side of midpoint, while the average for women would land closer toward intuitive. If you place these two bell curves alongside each other, you'll notice a sizable difference between the average tendency of men and the average tendency of women. Of course, you will also notice that there are a number of men who are intuitive in their orientation and many women who are factual. Given the distribution of human dynamics along this curve, it would be an inaccurate overgeneralization to claim that all men are one way and all women are another. After all, there is a lot of overlap on the graph. In fact, research suggests that about 20%, 1 in 5, is hardwired.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.